very much, and it's really great to be here. Thank you to the organizers for inviting me, and the sponsors for making this all possible. Thank you also to Bradford for going through 75 slides in 20 minutes. So now I'm inspired to do the same. So I will go through 75 slides in 20 minutes. As advertised, I'm Chris Wiggins, and I split my time between Columbia University, where I'm an associate professor of applied mathematics, and the New York Times, where I'm chief data scientist. I won't be able to talk in detail about everything, so I put up a short URL if you want to just read the references behind what I'm saying. Good. So, chief data scientist at the New York Times, it means I lead the data science group, so I should tell you how we think about data science. Data science means many different things at different companies. For example, a few years ago, Lars can speak to this better than I, but my understanding is that a few years ago, Facebook simply relabeled all of their data analysts data scientists. At the New York Times, we use an orthodox definition from ancient times, namely 2010, when Drew Conway suggested that group data science is the intersection between machine learning and a particular area of expertise. And many of the problems that we solve as a group within a 3,000-person company are trying to figure out how to integrate machine learning into that company's process. So we're not blessed with the situation Bradford described, in which you build a company sophisticated from the beginning, from birth, you're an AI company. We are a company that's trying to solve a mission, namely excellent journalism and sort of saving democracy to the best we can. And how are we going to integrate machine learning into that process and leverage machine learning solutions? So that is what's going on at the New York Times. Now, you may not think that the New York Times is a tech company. You may think that the New York Times is still what it was in 1851. Here's an image of the first New York Times from 1851 in the form of a dead tree. And I want to explain to you where my group sits within that org chart. So I have to show you the org chart for the New York Times. Here's the org chart for the New York Times. Church, state. That's a mindset we use in the States, where people talk about church and state often to separate people who are trying to enforce a mission and people who are trying not to go out of business. So at the New York Times, church is where the journalists are. So the things that you see, like anything like graphics or the upshot or something like that, that all happens in the church. Those are the journalists, the people who possess and defend the craft of journalism. Everything else is state, or sometimes called the business side. That's where my group sits. So church is things you see, like the great graphics, or the great upshot group that does the journalism. I am in state, I'm in the business side, trying to think about how we deploy these solutions to enhance that journalism, to make sure that that journalism gets read. And one of the criteria for getting read is not going out of business. So I sit in a particular group called Data. As of a few years ago, there is a centralized data group that contains the data analysts and the data scientists as well. And you may wonder why the New York Times has data, or you may not, but I'll tell you why. The New York Times has data in part because of this innovation on January 22, 1996, when the New York Times introduced a website, which they reported on with the quaint headline, "The New York Times introduces a website." Once you have a website, you have an abundance of data, right? So in 1996, when people introduced websites, they thought, "Ooh, this is great, this will be our online presence. Like, this will be a different shingle, or a different marketing channel or something." And a few years afterwards, once people started making companies like the Google, or, you know, later LinkedIn, people realized, oh my gosh, having a website means that you have a microscope for understanding all of your customer interactions at scale. Right, so instead of doing a focus group with 30 people and asking them how they might feel about using their product, you know at scale how people actually do use your product. So the New York Times was a little slow coming to this. I think it was in 2012 when the New York Times started tracking every event, which was around the time that I showed up looking to do a sabbatical from Columbia. So we now realize that the website is not just an online presence, it's also a microscope for understanding your audience. Understanding sounds like an academic word, academic meaning useless, but I assure you that they are not interested in these data for academic reasons. They're interested in understanding these data for reasons outlined on the right-hand slide, which is money. So here's money as a function of time, specifically money flowing from advertisers to newspapers and magazines as a function of time. In billions of dollars. So starting out half a century ago, good times, by the late 90s, really good times, everybody's flying business class, and then something happens and the money eventually just goes away. So the lifeblood of journalism has been the business model of newspapering, and the business model of newspapering is advertising, and that money just evaporated. right? And that's actually before the end of the economy in 2008. There was something much more transformative happening even before. And that means that every publisher is now in search of a repeatable and scalable business model, which means that under Steve Blank's definition, every publisher is now a startup. New York Times, BuzzFeed, Vox, doesn't matter who you are. Every publisher is now in search of a scalable and repeatable journalism. And that means journalism itself is in search for a repeatable, scalable business model. We as a species do not know if there exists a business model for journalism in 2017. It's kind of exciting. So, fun times. Where did the money go? Well, the money pretty much went to Google and Facebook. So at this point, 90% of every digital dollar that's spent on digital advertising just going straight to Facebook and Google. Congratulations, Lars. We'll hear more about that from Lars later. So the New York Times takes this threat seriously. What did they do? Well, they reported on it. So the New York Times sent some of its journalists to think hard about innovation. And in 2014, they put out a report on innovation, creatively called Innovation. And you can go look at that report. And one of the things that the report recommends is more data everywhere. That, you know, there's room for data to influence or to assist both church and state, which is useful for me. So now I want to teach you two things. So there's two things that I want you to take away from this. One is a little Rosetta Stone for technologists to try to explain to non-technologists what we do and what questions the non-technologists should be asking. So the little Rosetta Stone goes like this. If I think about how I describe learning within my group, which is a bunch of machine learning people, and how I describe learning to people inside the audience, you know, product people, marketing people, CEOs, people who don't speak calculus. How do I explain to them, what do I do? So the words that I use are, I say, look, are you looking for a descriptive model, a predictive model, or a prescriptive model? Are you asking me to make a simpler explanation to you of what the world is? Are you asking me to predict what's going to happen in the absence of treatment? Are you asking me what treatment to make in order to optimize some things that you want? And inside my group, I say, shh, don't tell anybody. Those are actually unsupervised, supervised, and reinforcement learning. I can't use those words with the normals. But it's a useful Rosetta Stone for many of the things that we're working on. It doesn't map perfectly, for example. Oh, sorry, I need to say one more thing. This is a graph from Michael Littman at Brown. I told him about this little Rosetta Stone, and he said, well, I really like that because under this graph, the things that I do, because he's a reinforcement learning guy, the things that I do are both the most difficult and the most valuable. So, descriptive, predictive, prescriptive modeling, how do I make it slightly more rigorous? I say to people I'm working with, look, are you willing to just tell me what you think I should be measuring about the audience? And then you want me to tell you a simpler description? Like in marketing, this is called segmentation. So they want segments, but you're free to say, I'm gonna pose that segmentation problem as unsupervised learning or clustering. Are you willing to tell me not only what attributes of the readers you think are important, but what you really want to know if they're gonna do? For example, you want to know if their subscribers are gonna cancel or not, or build a churn model. Then you have to do more work as my friend and collaborator. You have to specify not only what you think is relevant about them, but also what you want them to do. Or you're asking me to tell you what marketing message to send, or which onboarding flow the user should go through. Then you need to get more granular with me. You need to be willing to specify what it is you want from them, what is it you think is relevant, and what actions are you willing to take? What levers, or what arms of a bandit, what actions are you willing to take? So that's a useful Rosetta Stone for going between the normals and my group. There's some examples of things that sort of involve all three, particularly if you're willing to make a really just generative model. So, for example, a generative model. So how do you think the recommendation engine works? Well, the way the recommendation works at the New York Times at present is a generative model that takes people and articles and represents them as different mixtures of things. Those of you who come from this background will not be surprised that this is a type of topic modeling. So we use a type of topic modeling that also combines with clicks via my friend Dave Bly, who's also, his office is next to mine at Columbia. So I said, you should come on down and let's do some damage. So inside here, you will recognize the plate structure for our LDA, and then you add to this something that basically gives you Netflix and LDA and one loss function. So that's what we use. En route, or as a byproduct, you're not only doing descriptions of things, but you also get predictions for whether or not people are going to click, and also implicitly a prescription, like what articles should I show which person. So the driving question there for the people who are the editors is, what articles should we show to which users? But you can do that in the form of a descriptive statement because you've written down a full generative model. predictive model. Where might you predict of the New York Times? Well, some of the problems are newsroom problems. So for example, we worked with Hiroko Taguchi several years ago, who was trying to look at federal databases of car accidents, because she had a hunch that there was a consistent problem that many of these car fatalities were happening via bad airbags. So she pointed us to this federal database of car fatalities, and it was all in XML, and it was horrible. But we worked with her to turn it into civilized Python, and once we had done that, then we can say, look, you give me the full text of an article, and I can find statistically interesting phrases that are either positively or negatively predictive of this was possibly an airbag, malperforming airbag fatality, you know, like suddenly deployed, or inadvertently, or burned, as opposed to Volkswagen, which at least in this, and Mercedes in this analysis, was anti-correlated with being a defective airbag. And that led to airbag recall process that's been big news ever since then. So we started working with her here, a whole bunch of articles came out around yonder, and eventually a big recall of these airbags. So that's an example of where you might want to use a predictive problem for journalism, because you want to help Hiroko Taguchi figure out what are the articles, or what are the individual fatalities that might be newsworthy. Where else might you want to predict things? Well, the canonical use case, like Marketing 101 for any subscription services, predict people churning. And in fact, my first day at the New York Times, I wrote an email to my then boss and said, we really need to build a churn model. So we did that. So we built a model that said, can we predict whether you're going to go from being a subscriber or a loyalist to churning, canceling your subscription? So here we wanted to balance predictive power and interpretability. So this is a second lesson that might be useful to you. The first lesson is to try to develop a Rosetta Stone for trying to help other people help your group by speaking the language that you can both speak about what sort of methods you want to use. The second is, people want predictive power, but they also want interpretability. And this is not a new lesson from this decade. This is actually a lesson learned in the writings of Leo Breiman many years ago. Way back yonder in 2001, Uncle Leo wrote this nice article about statistical modeling the two cultures. And one of his points was, you can have methods like random forest that are A plus at predicting, but they are an F for interpretability. But other times, if you really want interpretability, you might just build a decision tree or something like that. And that's a lesson that we've been able to diffuse throughout the New York Times is, you know, we can build you a model that's gonna tell you who are the at-risk people, but sometimes you don't wanna know the at-risk individuals, you wanna know the risky behaviors. And so depending on whether we're working with different teams, we will work on models which at the New York Times are called strategic or tactical, but they're basically interpretable versus in predictive models, which is something to keep in mind now that we're all in the world of deep learning, which, you know, as Yann LeCun said to me years ago, I'm anti-interpretability. You know, so deep learning is not a modeling style which excels on interpretability. The marketing people actually want to know some super cool features. What are the features that indicate somebody's going to die? Die and cancel their subscription. Other things that we want to predict. Other things we want to predict. Well, the New York Times actually still makes dead trees and ships them to people, and for that reason, it would be useful to know how many copies of the newspaper to send to different stores, so we actually have an optimizations problem. This is nice because I actually can do carefully controlled experiments. I can run an A/B test and have different algorithms sent to different stores, and at the end of the day, I have a KPI in units of US dollars, namely, how many data scientist salaries did I save by using the correct algorithm, rather than a set of heuristics encoded in COBOL on an AS400 machine from the late 90s. Driving question is really, how many copies do you want to send? So there's prediction in there, but there's also a prescription. Like, we want to be able to prescribe what to do. Another example where you want to predict and prescribe, it's really prescribe, is the art and science of getting our journalism to readers. This is a quote from the Innovation Report. So in 2014, the New York Times decided, you know, maybe we should try to think about the relationship with a story once we hit publish. So, you know, for most of the history of journalism, your relationship with the story ended when it went to the presses, right? That's why we use the phrase stop the presses. But like in the digital world, the relationship with the story starts when you press publish. That's when people start commenting, that's when you start distributing it on your social channels or mailing it out by newsletter. In some ways, there's a whole other relationship with journalism that starts once you hit publish. At the New York Times, that's called audience development. One of the things that the audience development group asked us was, can you help us figure out some logical way of deciding which stories we should be promoting when on which social channels? And fortunately for me, I had read a paper by Lars Backstrom back in 2009, about how to do this. Someone said, that is impossible. I said, yeah, there's a literature on that. So we built this fancy machine learning algorithm that for any story, would predict how much engagement that story is gonna get in the next 30 minutes if you promoted it on different social channels, and if you did not, and the delta is basically your treatment effect, and that gives us a way of saying to the editors, this would be a useful story, comma, channel combination to promote right now. So we built all this machine learning in school. The software engineer, do this awesome MapReduce, Python to make this predictive model, but then how do I get the editors to open up Python? We just cannot get editors to open up Python. And so then we thought about making a web app, but we can't get editors to stop editing and open up a new web app. But the editors love Slack. So we figured out we can just take this whole process and make it into a Slack bot, and the editors never need to leave Slack. So there was a lot of design thinking here. We didn't name it HAL 2000 or Terminator or whatever. We named it Blossom. And Blossom is sort of friendly and non-threatening and has a picture of flowers. And then you can interact with Blossom and say, Blossom, Facebook. And Blossom will tell you, here's a bunch of stories you really should be promoting on Facebook right now and the different channels you should be promoting them on. And Blossom can even interrupt you and say, no, seriously, please stop what you're doing and promote this story on Facebook right now. So we want to leverage methods. So like in terms of methods, this is like a product decision. But what ML should we be leveraging here? Well, we want methods that are performant and quick to learn and quick to evaluate and to update. We tried many different methods. We ended up using a boosting approach. Again, just to get back to the literature, this was a paper that inspired me to think that this was at all possible by three great ones, including somebody who's going to be speaking later. And this paper I had come across when I was doing some technical advisory work to a social media company in New York City in 2010. And then we leveraged boosting, which is an old idea, right, 1996, old as the hills. Still went pretty damn well, I gotta say. Anyway, so the driving question there is really a prescription problem. Like, I need to make a decision as an editor. Help me decide what to do. It's different than just predicting what's going to happen in the absence of treatment, and it's different from just describing all of our users as a bunch of clusters. So many of the questions that I found, so one lesson for me is working with real people often want to work with you for decision support. They have difficult, they have a day, they have a job, they're journalists, they're editors, they want to get things done, they have very difficult decisions to make. And those decisions to make moments are the moments in which you can be really useful to them. So many of the things that you work on are really prescriptive problems in disguise. But that doesn't mean that reinforcement learning is always the right tool. Some of the stories we worked on are like, which stories should you translate to a different language for international expansion of the New York Times? Which stories to recommend? Which records should Heroku to which you investigate? Which behaviors should we try to influence on using our marketing? How many copies to send? Which stories to promote? That's what the Slack bot was for. These are all difficult decisions that real people at the Times have to make that the data science group is trying to help with using machine learning. So all of these are things in which you hold the hand of somebody to get more granular. There are a couple of methods from reinforcement learning you can leverage here, slow methods and fast methods. The slow methods are things like you run an A-B test, and then you want to take that A-B test and use it as the basis for a targeting strategy. So you don't do it in real time, you do it in batch. The mathematics for that is the same whether you're running a randomized control trial or you're doing marketing campaigns. And it touches on machine learning literature from John Langford and co-workers, building on older statistical ideas, which also shows up in the causal inference literature. But the idea is basically go directly for the thing that you want. The thing that you want is to know what decision to make, which is different than trying to predict what's going to happen if you make that decision. Or as Botnick says, or as Leon Batu Botnick says, Botnick's razor is, when solving a learning problem of interest, do not solve a more complex problem as an intermediate step. Like, let's say you're Google DeepMind and you want to learn how to play Atari, like you want to predict whether Pac-Man should go left or right, or prescribe rather, but you don't really want to predict what's going to happen if Pac-Man goes right. You just want to know what is the thing that's going to optimize the cost function. The fast way to do it, of course, is by bandits. As Bradford was saying, you think something's super cool now and eventually it's going to become a commodity. So here's a 2001 paper by Li Hong Li and when he was back at Yahoo. Showing that you could use this very old idea from 1930s for optimally doing ad targeting and showing that it was beating the new hotness, which in this case was Lin UCB. And now it's commodities. Like now Google will do bandits for you as a service. So as part of Google's analytics problem, it'll just do the bandits for you. So those are some lessons learned in terms of the workflow.
Bradford showed an example of a workflow problem in credit lending. In terms of the workflow, often in my relationship with real people, they come to me and they have some sort of problem, like, tell me about my users, and that's an exploratory analysis. And then I say, okay, well, what do you really want the users to do? And then we have the opportunity to learn from observational data, a predictive model. And then I can say, okay, well, what are you willing to do in order to get those people to do that thing? And then we have the opportunity to do A/B testing and optimization. And of course, really, it's not a flow. You know, it's just like science, the same rules apply. You learn some things, it refines your model, you go back and forth and iterate. What does the group do? You know, the thing that sets us apart from the data analysts is we actually try to ship work and code. So we try to impact roadmaps in the sense of giving insight to people, but we also try to build APIs that other people can call, like the Slack bots basically are all microservices that we can turn into APIs. And we try to ship data product. We do sometimes actually build web apps that people interact with. So sometimes we're trying to do things for humans, sometimes for computers. And the other thing that we've done to try to influence things is to realize that not everything you do with data is the same skill set. So before I started there was not a concept that data engineering was a different thing. There was not a concept that data analytics was somehow different from data science. And now those are all job titles. So things have gotten much more sophisticated in terms of how we understand what we do when we talk about data. Yeah, even in academia, you know, we don't really understand that like data engineering, data analytics, and data science are really different things, but at least in the New York Times, those are different job titles. Good, so those are some of the lessons learned at the New York Times. I hope they're useful to you and your companies. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. And now questions. There's a question.
There's a hand waving in the back. I give that to that person.
It's good. Yes, okay. So you mentioned that you're using a bunch of different algorithms. So I want to know, first of all, how many you're using like from day to day. And the second part of my question would be, how much of your work is dedicated to already working algorithms, and how much of you're putting to develop now a new ones?
The first question is, how many different algorithms are we using? The answer is all of them. We are quite Catholic. We have things running in TensorFlow. We have LARC-C. We'll use anything. We have random forests. We have linear regression. And sometimes the right tool for the right job is a histogram. So we try to use what the right tool for the right job is. And the second question was, how do you divide your time between existing methods and new ones? We believe in... there was a great tweet from somebody on Twitter years ago that was like, if you want to productionalize machine learning, look at some academic papers, look at what is the method they all compare to as the dummy baseline, do that first. So we always try to do the dumbest thing first. Like it's very easy, somebody gives you a new problem, you're like, oh sweet, I'm gonna do this graph diffusion for transductive, blah, blah, blah. Do the dumbest thing possible first. Like think through like, what is the thing of which this is the fancier version? And do that first. If it doesn't meet the KPI, if it doesn't like perform, then you can start thinking about how to do something fancy, and then you go beyond scikit. But we always try to do the dumbest thing possible first. So we probably spend 80% of our time solving things using scikit-learn, and that's awesome. The client is happy, and we get to go on to the next problem, and we productionalize it. So I would say there's some sort of 80-20 between using existing methods and then deriving innovations on top of that. But you always do the dumb thing first. Don't do the fancy thing unless the dumb thing doesn't work.
Another question here.
Thank you for the talk. You mentioned generative models. Do you think thinking about bringing them to the journalism itself, like in China, they have published a machine writing paper already, article.
Your question is, am I going to use an algorithm to replace the people in the newsroom?
Kind of.
The answer is no. And there's a couple of reasons why that would be bad. One reason is they would hate me. The other is that we are at a point in time in 2017 in which the New York Times doesn't have a technical moat, and it does have a data moat, but mostly has a craft moat. Like in the States, there are a few companies where if you were the best at this particular craft, the craft of journalism, there's only a couple of companies you really, really, really want to be at. And so that's, you know, like if we started competing with other companies on like AI to do robot journalism, there would be a moat between me and some other company that has a bunch of VC money and can hire the best nerds out of Google and have Google me, right? But what we do have is like the best journalists in the world. So it would be bad for business for me to go to the newsroom and say, I'm gonna replace y'all with AI.
Just a question from business point of view. So you actually, your department applies data science methods to maximize revenue from advertising. But I mean, from customer perspective, are customers happy? Are they satisfied with this technology?
Yeah, so I emphasized in the print allocation problem, the one where we send different copies to different algorithms to different stores, I emphasized the fact that the y-axis was actually US dollars, because that's unusual. Most of the problems that we work on are ones for which the goal is not easily quantified, and it's definitely not easily turned into US dollars. So for example, finding the right content to promote, or in a project I didn't talk about where we basically learn who reads what where, so like what are the topics that over-index for which different groups of people where on the planet, that's something where the goal is to render in beautiful, awesome D3 to a bunch of marketers from outside the company some really deep understanding of our audience. There's really no KPIs there. So definitely don't think that all of the things we do are figuring out a KPI and optimizing it. If anything, the overall thing that we want to maximize for is trust. Right? Like any subscription service, any journalism subscription service, we're trying to optimize for trust. And that is not a SQL query. Right? There's no easy way to turn that into something that just counts. So most of the problems we work with are ones for which it's not just US dollars that I'm trying to optimize on. There's a lot of thinking to go through, like what is the way of taking this goal of the craft or this goal of the business owner and turning it into a machine learning task. But that's part of I think the data science art is taking a real problem from some domain, reframing it as a machine learning task, doing the machine learning, and then figuring out how to help somebody else put that machine learning task to work.
We have time for last very quick question.
It might be just a stupid question, so it'll be quick. Because you said you are in the States, not in the church, but the Arabic article seemed that you actually gave the church some data to write an article. So does the church have their own data science team or not? Thank you.
That's a great question. So, that was sort of transgressive for me to work with Hiroko. Basically, I was in Japan, somebody said we should meet, we went to coffee, and that's not what we usually do. So the church has several data groups. So the church has a data journalism group, who are awesome. They have a data viz group, graphics group, and they are awesome. And it also has a computer-assisted reporting group, who are awesome. So very rarely do we do computer-assisted reporting. And the act that I did there, I would call an example of computer-assisted reporting. Computer-assisted reporting as a term of art is actually much older than data journalism. There's a conference called MICAR. People have been doing computer-assisted reporting for a while. Like many other things about the New York Times, the people in the world who are the best in the business happen to be in that particular group. They're great. It's usually the case that computer-assisted reporting happens in that group, basically just because I happen to be in Tokyo and met Hiroko, that sort of transgressed the church-state divide. I mean, I'm happy to be useful to people in the newsroom, but that's a particular case for which computer-assisted reporting is a job for which the New York Times actually does have a function.
Thank you again.